going scrimmage like you the champion. You might win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just lost one. Now, how come your top turn cold? Gain the whole world for the price of your soul. Trying to grab hold of what you can't control. Now you all lost with a sight to behold.
Day two.
Wisdom is better than silver and gold.
Fly women making history.
Folks, my name is Aisha. I am the founder and director of HipHopEX. We are in our third year of existence, and we up in here in and on these virtual streets, continuing our mission to create intergenerational programming that centers hip-hop's brilliance and excellence, to create experiences for people to get to know hip-hop a little bit more, get to meet some dope human beings. And every month in this virtual year, we have been dedicating 1 week to do some programming around a theme, and it being March, which is just the fly month. I was born in March. Shout out Pisces. I know we in Aries seasons, but Pisces forever. But March is a Women's History Month. And so we wanted to take our use our three-day series as an opportunity to celebrate and elevate amazing women who are doing some game-changing work, not just in hip hop, but in education and mindfulness and supporting Black teaching artists. So today is the second day of our series. So if you all are not familiar, we are using the webinar format, which means you will not see your beautiful, gorgeous, dope selves on the screen. You will see the presenter, you'll see myself and any shared screens that we have. But towards the end of our session, if you would like to pose your question, I don't really have bars. That was a complete accident. But if you would like to pose a question, you will be given permission to unmute yourself and even jump on video if that is comfortable for you. We are also live streaming on Facebook. And so we'll be checking the comment boxes there to see, and the questions there to see what we can pull from to engage with our amazing artists. Okay. I'm super excited. I got to tell myself to like sit on my hands because I am a huge, huge, huge fan of this human who's been really inspirational to me on many levels. So I feel like y'all might see me rocking because I'm just so excited. But I am going to take this opportunity to introduce our amazing guest for today. So today we will be chopping it up with none other than a Toni Blackman. Toni Blackman, the first U.S. hip-hop ambassador with the U.S. State Department, has traveled to 48 countries, 48, speaking, teaching, and performing. This rapper, poet, director, and producer received fellowships from Echoing Green Foundation, OSI, and served as a visiting scholar at NYU and was one of the first rap artists in residence at several institutions. Highly respected for her hip hop activism, work as the creator of Rhyme Like a Girl and the Freestyle Union Cypher Workshop, Toni is a leading expert on the cypher. Listen, there's so much more that can be said, but let's go ahead and welcome Toni Blackman. Put your real hands and your virtual hands together as we welcome Toni to the stage.
What worry? If you want to keep it all going and energy flowing, we must remember and know, worry does not make us strong. It just brings a negative on. It becomes like a...
All right. It's Tuesday, so that's the little snippet of the Tuesday new music exclusive. So maybe if we are fortunate and blessed, we might get a little live sesh some towards the end. But Toni, welcome and thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you for having me here.
Absolutely. How are you feeling today? I know you're a busy human. So how are you doing?
I am feeling good. I am feeling slightly spent. Because I woke up the other Sunday and realized I hadn't had an off day all month.
Oh, okay.
It, goes against what I preach.
Well, listen, this is a guilt-free, judgment-free zone. So I will give you, I know one of our panelists from last night, Juliana Calderon, took us through some mindfulness and breathing, and my energy has been like,
yeah,
all the way up. So I'm just going to take some of that and I'm going to just boom, I'm going to send it straight through the screen to New York or wherever you are and get that to you. Acknowledge that, you know, thank you for being honest, right? Like we got to keep it real.
No, real. I forgot to, my backdrop is over there in the hall and I forgot to move it behind me. And I'm just sitting here realizing, ooh, there's no backdrop, but thank God it's clean. So
I feel like I done seen up into so many people's homes. I feel like my students know what my whole entire apartment looks like.
Right.
I have one zone that the computer doesn't come into, at least not the Zoom room. That's the bedroom.
Yeah.
I don't know if folks can resonate with that, but you know, listen, I'm like, people have seen the dishes. I don't understand why I always have dishes. I live by myself. Like, what is happening? What is really going on?
Yes.
Well, listen, so for folks who've never been to one of these, this is a conversation series. So we're just going to chop it up. I have a ton of questions, but this is not about me, although a little bit maybe, but just kidding. I'm going to ask you a few questions, Toni, just to get things started. I shared this with Toni in a phone conversation that in my class on embodiment and in my class on hip hop pedagogy, your talks on the cypher are like a mainstay, yeah, on the syllabus. And as an educator, it really cannot be said enough around how the energy and the ethos of a cypher is something that I think most schooling has missed. Just trying to put people in lines and rows. And once we get to your talk and discuss, it's always like this beautiful aha moment. So I'm really excited to chop it up with you about the cypher. But I wondered if you, for folks who may not be familiar with your work or with your story, and you can tell any version of this that you want to. So Tell the Truth Tuesday. I just made that up. Your bio, 48 countries, rapper, freestyle, rap like a girl, activism. Like, let's do a brown sugar thing, right? So Toni, when did you meet hip hop?
Well, hip hop and I met as a young girl. I remember it because I remember my uncle was dissing the music I was listening to, because he said it wasn't real music, because it was not Parliament Funkadelic. It was not the Barclays. It was not Sly and the Family Stone. What is that? And, but I fell in love with it. I fell in love with hip hop. And I started rapping for fun on the way to school in the eighth grade. And then I just never stopped. I think in high school, I got serious about it when I was a cheerleader. And I was in charge of the rallies, in charge of the pep rallies. So I would take the popular songs and then we would change the words to fit my team. And I didn't realize at the time, but there was a teacher that pulled me aside and she told me, you know, people make a living doing what you're doing out there. It didn't register in my head till 15 years later. I spent all that time trying to fit inside the box, and I wish I had remembered her name. I'm going to try to find this woman, but she tried to tell me, and I heard her. But yeah, I was producing, I was writing, I was directing, I was consulting.
Come on.
Designing.
Come on. Come
as on. As a teenager.
Resume already like a CVS receipt as a teenager.
Yeah, and so people ask me, how do you do this, this, and that, and all that, and that? Well, I didn't, you know, and my cousin was being interviewed about me, my cousin Carla, for a documentary, and they were asking her about me, and she started saying stuff, and I forgot. And she was like, well, cousin Toni used to produce plays and productions in grandma's backyard and charge a nickel for the people to get in. And it was all this stuff I forgot, because I've been so immersed in the work of my purpose. I was on purpose before I knew what purpose was. I had already answered my calling and stepped into it. And so it's just such a part of me now. It's hard to delineate between work and joy, which is why I can't stop working. But I know I need to stop working because I had a severe burnout crash in 2016 trying to save the world. So working on it.
Okay. See, listen, I'm trying to like, I don't know if I'm going to take notes by hand. I'm trying to put in the chat, but that was such a beautiful like moment. Like I was on purpose before I knew what purpose was. And again, like, I think particularly, and I'm curious, you know, how you've encountered this throughout your journey, particularly as an educator. And I don't think education only happens in a formal brick and mortar building, right? So when I say, you know, we barbershop, beauty salon, AT house, all those things. And when you're listing off, oh, I was producing, I was delegating, I was directing. And then we think about how different forces try to tell us, oh, you have to learn those skills later as you grow up and you start thinking, well,
especially as women and girls.
That part, I was like, so as a woman, and you reflect back on little Toni, who's out here entrepreneurian, I'm gonna make that a verb, saying, if you wanna see this production, come up off that nickel. As you think about adult Toni and thinking back to little Toni and other little Black and brown girls, what do you say? What's the message in the bottle around the amazing skills that we just inherently have? What do you say to little Toni or to other little Black and brown girls?
Well, you know, it's funny. I was just having a conversation earlier with one of my mentees. She's Latina. And we were just talking through this, you know? And I was just like, she was like, imagine if you were a dude, would things be different? I'm like, yeah. Everything would be so different. When I think about what I was able to accomplish and achieve, what I was able to take from ideation to a reality stage. And I don't know, what do I say? I don't, I'm not sure what exactly to say. I don't know, this is my third conversation today. So I'm processing different audiences.
Listen, you are, just so you know, and I know about that, like, did I already say this earlier? Am I hearing, hello? Am I caught into the, am I in like the Twilight Zone? But just so you know, Miss Toni, you are free to be as you want to be. We don't put on no airs on this conversation. And I think, like, I'm interested in like asking myself that question, because I feel like as an adult, like 4 decades took me to be like, everything that was around me as a little girl in my community is actually what has really been foundational to who I am, to what I do, and how to sustain myself. And I think about as being a Black girl, a Black woman, how there are a lot of forces who try to tell you it's got to be more professional, or it looks like this, or it walks like this. And so I think about all the multiple intelligences and assets and wealth that we have.
So look, when I think about these multiple intelligences, I think about the gift of the ability to flow. I think about the power of intuition. I think about being an intuitive facilitator, which, because I don't have detailed lesson plans, does not mean that I'm less intelligent than the educator who's sitting next to me. Because I can walk into a space, feel the vibration and energy of the space, make connections, make eye contact with the participants or the students, boom. And like that, make learning magic happen. And that's something that I disrespected in myself, because I was judged. You know, my first job out of college started from an internship. I was an intern in undergrad. And then as I graduated, I got offered a position as a trainer, as an associate trainer with this media training firm in Washington, D.C. And I watched how my colleagues, who were older, much more seasoned, how much prep time they needed to make it hot. I needed about 10% of the prep time to make it hot. And how my boss wanted to make me feel less than, unprofessional, and the list can go on and on and on. And now looking back, I just wish I would have had mentorship or some sort of guidance, because what I had was a gift. What they didn't have was that gift. And there was that resentment, that envy. This is also something else I wish we talked more about. Human nature, the shadow aspects of human nature. We don't discuss it enough. And when we do discuss it, we discuss it from a point of victimization and hurt and pain, as opposed to just reality. It is reality that there will be people who will envy you. It is part of life. So why don't we talk about it just as matter of factually as we do pregnancy? You know, or how the body falls off if we don't take care of it. We lose muscle if we stop strength training. I just feel like there are certain aspects of life that could enhance not only our own journey, but it will give us the fuel to be able to impact even more lives. Just living in truth and speaking in truth and having integrity around what life experience really looks like, and not telling folks, especially younger folks, or even grown women, oh, just ignore them. Oh, well, sometimes you're gonna work with mean people, just ignore them. And so how do you ignore a wound? How do you ignore hurt? Yeah. How do you ignore betrayal?
Mm.
Yeah.
I mean, So many things that you just dropped there. Like I'm just gonna have to like let my hand surrender and catch the recording of my own self. but one, the intuitive facilitator. And how the multiple, like it is a nuanced thing. Like you're an MC, you're a rapper. Folks know that that is something that I wish, like I, in another life, it was going to be great. But this one, the God said, not so much. Well, I marvel at the ability for folks to put together rhyme, to search for words, grab them, yeah. Sentences, phrases, disses, the whole nine, rhythmically, on purpose,
right.
All the math, the vocabulary, like there's so much linguistic power and capital. And that is also a deep type of listening, because if I'm going after you, I have to listen. I can't repeat something you said, or if I am, I got to figure out how I'm using that as like, how I'm going to play with that. And so when I think it seems so duh to me to know that like you started rapping for fun as a little girl, those like that was in you. And so like, of course you're an intuitive facilitator. Right. And I always, there's some questions that I wish like to think about human nature that I didn't get. That's always like the, well, what do we do about misogyny,
right,
and hip hop and rap? And I'm like, as if misogyny didn't exist before.
Yeah.
Like, please don't address, don't say that's a hip hop's address. It didn't birth that, right? But
right.
Think about how we can raise the bar. Yes, that's a critical conversation, but like, again, getting to what are the assets? What's the human nature? How do we like talk about things more matter of factly and uphold the beautiful and not just the struggle, right? And so I'm just holding on to those nuggets that you dropped. And I'm wondering, like, as that rapping little girl who had that sage prophetess of a teacher, mm-hmm. But then found yourself back in the work some 15 years later, what helped you or who helped you kind of turn on the light bulb and go, this is inside of me, this isn't a deficit? Like, who were you listening to or who was around you? You mentioned the word mentorship, like what or who helped you kind of go, all right, Toni, let's go this way?
Well, you know, my writing, I think of him as my poetry mentor, literary mentor, Ethelbert Miller. I met him when I was in college and undergrad at Howard, and I started going to him for poetry because I was on scholarship with the speech and debate team, and I competed in poetry interpretation as one of my events. And what he did was he introduced me to a lot of concepts around life, and it was almost very paternal. And I think I stuck to him like glue because my father was not in my life, you know, on a consistent basis. And I needed that energy. And he was just ever so consistent, not only in my life, but in the lives of many others. And then Deborah Minkart, who is the founder of Teaching for Change, a nonprofit that supports teachers and educators. And I started to work because of Ethelbert, I met Deborah. And then I started to work with Deborah, offered me a job. And this job came after I had quit that corporate training job. And I was waiting tables at Uno's Pizzeria. And Deborah was like, no, come on over here. Come over here, baby, come on over here. And so it was a storytelling project working with immigrant mothers. And then she discovered that I was a hip hop head and that I knew all of this stuff about hip hop. And she sent me into the classrooms to work with teachers. And I tell you, I was more scared of those teachers than I was any group of kids. And I was like, oh, no, you will not, I will not do that. But then she told me how much it paid. And, you know, it was 5 times more than what I was making for one workshop. I was like, oh, word? For 2 hours? So that's when I started doing the Hip Hop 101 and fell in love with it. I fell in love with professional development. I fell in love with teaching my music and my culture. And that's when I started to recognize the value in what I had to offer. And then Deborah also sat me down and helped me to really look at what my strengths are. And because I worked with mothers, many of whom didn't speak English, yet I was able to communicate with them. And yes, I had translators, but I was able to have make heart connections with these mothers. And it was something I didn't notice. And she told me that is a gift. Part of the gift is that I don't see barriers. They exist, but I don't internalize the barriers. And so it makes me an effective educator or a trainer. Like, my education is not as a teacher, but as a trainer. And I was able to apply what I learned in graduate school and training and what I learned from that training firm job. And I think Deborah is the first person who opened my eyes to really understanding the value of what it is that I offer and what came naturally for me, and to work it, to work that.
I love it. I love it. I love that your first, that you were teaching or training teachers first. Which of course it's important to work with young people, of course. But I know, especially for other educators who might be on the call, they're like, yeah, sometimes we need a little help too. But I love that you were like, oh, I can't go back, but wait, how much? Now I'm thinking of like, ask a teacher now, like, oh, I do it. Like,
well, you know what? At that time, DC public school teachers, their checks were late. Those were not happy campers.
No. No, no, you don't mess with teachers' money. I think we know that one. Not anybody's money, but especially teachers.
Teachers work hard enough, man. Pay them.
I know, we treat them like Swiss Army knives, and they're not. It's not fair. It's not fair. Yeah. Shout out to all of our teachers who are having to remix and try to take care of self, family, and other people's family from their living room. So y'all always get a hug and a two-step from me. So I want to... I want to ask you about these 48 countries. I know I've been asked, like, how is it? I call myself the dancing diplomat because I've gone to school for international relations. And, you know, then they ask 18 and 19 year olds to do a really silly thing. They go, declare your major. I'm like, I can't even get a legal drink. And you want me to tell you what I want to do for the rest of my life? Like, it's so silly. But I was already in my international relations classes deep. And I was like, but musical theater. Like, mama, I want to sing. Like, mama, I want to dance. And my and I just couldn't switch majors. It's not an economic reality. And so my friend was like, don't worry about it. You're going to do both of them. You'll be a dancing diplomat. And so just delving into work as like a dancer, as a choreographer, utilizing hip hop as dance as like the language for the artwork, for convening on stage and having conversations with people. I got invited by the State Department to go to Honduras, and I was like, she was a prophet, it's happening. And like, it was a day, right? It was a day where the young people I was working with were like aliens. I don't know what was up with them that day. And I answered my phone in the middle of a class. Yes, I did. That's the kind of day it was. We're just telling the truth on a Tuesday. But it was the State Department, and they were like, we heard you speak Spanish. We heard you have a conflict resolution, international conflict resolution background. We want to send you to Honduras. And I was like, y'all see, yes, when, now? Like right now, y'all could come get me out this class right now. But so for me, that was like this beautiful moment. And then I realized, beyond my little neighborhood of St. Louis, beyond being in DC, how huge and powerful hip hop was, like literally in these small towns in Honduras. I was like, this is crazy. You know, even if I didn't speak Spanish, there'd be some kind of connection through this culture. And so like, that's my story, but you're someone like, I'm very familiar, like you're the first. And I was like, this is big sister Toni. And I'm like, what was that? How did it start for you? This the ambassadorship with the State Department. And then if you could talk about, like, are you still doing that work?
Well, it started. How did it start? Yeah, well, I think I got, okay, I got a call in 2000 from the State Department, and it was a woman by the name of EJ Montgomery. She was an African-American woman who was maybe late 60s, maybe 70s or something, but she had been there a long time, she told me. And And then she told me John Palmer Claridge, who was at the Cultural Affairs Division in Arlington County, Virginia, had told her about me. They were looking through the Source magazine and they were looking for someone that met all their criteria. And then he was like, you're not gonna find the person there, but I know who. And he called me and told me to send him my press kit. And then she called, and then she mentioned, as soon as she said Senegal, Ghana, and Ivory Coast, I was like, oh, yes. And that was it. And I was so naive because I shouldn't have just been saying yes to a government entity like that, but it worked out. And I was already very much familiar with Senegalese culture from my experiences in DC. I knew the food, I knew the music. I knew a lot about the country, and had taken Francophone courses in undergrad, like everything. And so I was ready for it. And initially they were gonna send a couple of MCs from Freestyle Union Cypher Workshop with me, but they decided just to send me. They chickened out. And it ended up being my second experience on the continent. I had already traveled a lot to South Africa, which is one of the reasons why I got the invitation. I had done cultural exchanges in South Africa through the Africa Exchange Foundation, through Arts International, and support from different arts presenters. And we ended that residency so powerfully. One, they had scheduled 500 free tickets for a concert, and over 2,000 people showed up. And thank God it was in outdoors. And then two, that cypher, the night I left, my plane was late. And so I had more time. When I got out of the van, the embassy van, to get dropped off, there were people there. And there were people there waiting to say goodbye to me. And it was the first time I ever cried in a cypher. And because the plane was late, we got to have one more cypher. So we danced, we freestyled, we beatbox, and it was a moment, yo. It was like, it was a moment. And I can't wait to do the documentary on the work because there are so many beautiful moments there. And I think it changed the trajectory of my entire career, my life. And at that moment, I knew that there was no other place I wanted my feet to be than on the soil of the continent of Africa when I did my work.
Beautiful. Thank you for sharing that. I mean, you mentioned, and I don't know if everybody who's joining, I know some folks have the experience of a cypher, have had different experiences. Oh,
connected to right. Cypher.
Yeah.
The cypher represents 360 degrees. It's about completion of thought, giving and exchanging energy, information, and ideas. The cypher is zero and the sum of all things at the same time. Legendary pop master Fable and once told me at a festival, he says, mankind's been ciphering for centuries. We dance in cypher circles. We pray in cyphers. We drum in cyphers. We eat in cyphers. The cypher is the circle. And it is a part of who we are as human beings. There's a reason why kindergarten teachers like circles. And there's a reason why when you study training and development, the circle is a huge part of making sure the environment is right for optimal learning in condensed periods of time. It's a really important space. And the cypher is sacred, the circle.
Yes. Yes. Listen, I'm like about to put the link if folks have not seen, like, I mean, I'm sure that you know that you can do this. I'm like, that was like the all the TED Talks together in like 60 seconds, like all the gems, but it's, I will make sure that we drop a link in the chat.
I've been defining it for a long
time. I mean, I know you had a little practice.
And you know, my book, Wisdom of the Cypher,
oh, yes,
will come out this year on
Red
Presents. So I'm really excited. And then I'm writing a piece about women and the cypher for another book. I don't know if I'm supposed to talk about their book.
You can talk. As far as I'm concerned.
I didn't ask them. But
right. So unhear that. Control Z. Undo.
But I'm gonna keep my title for now.
The wisdom of the cipher, like, I it seems so natural. Somebody gave me what I'm taking as a compliment. They told me that I teach like a kindergarten teacher. And I was like, thank you. I mean, because I think it is like, again, back to that human nature, the very fundamental things about our experience. Like, we don't go to lines and unidirectional naturally. Like, we don't. And I know for many of us that identify as Indigenous people, it's just not in our actual collective DNA. And so it is zero and the sum of everything. It is energy. And I think sometimes what some folks miss, and why I love your work on it, is because I've noticed this with my students, even my graduate students, that a lot of people's contact with the cypher is through rap battles.
Yes.
And I try to say, like, without saying, because I also feel like, because as you said, cyphers are sacred, there's a way to understand the rules or the protocol that you were supposed to experience without like reading a checklist. But I try to let people know, like, the cypher isn't a place where I'm like, I'm about to rip your head off. That's not, what it is, only, you know?
Yeah, I just did an artist residency in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, and it was virtual. Yawande Austin and King Alesh, the Congolese artist, pulled me into this residency. And it was interesting because initially they had the Fridays of our residency, there was gonna be a battle on Instagram, a freestyle battle they called it. And I was like, why are we calling it that? And why does it have to be that? And it was just this moment of, first of all, that's not the place for a battle, Instagram. And then second of all, like, isn't this about unity and the upliftment of women and honoring Women's Month? And they agreed, you know, that we would have Friday ciphers. And I believe that the cipher can be used as a place to prepare for battle. But there's no battling in the cipher because you have to battle yourself first. And it's about self-mastery, because you are your own worst enemy. And when we have mastered self, like the true warrior, in The Art of War by Sun Tzu, and there's a bunch of martial arts literature that talks about this, but the true warrior who is masterful does not bleed, right? So you're able to, I took you out now already, look at that. Like, you practice, and it's important to practice your form. The same way someone who's doing martial arts is practicing their form, you have to practice your form as an MC if you are truly committed to the art and the craft. But everybody is not, you know? And I think at one point I was a purist about this, I was preachy about this, and now I'm just factual about it. These are the facts. If the first response you have is to go gut level, punch somebody else, and you got nothing else in your arsenal, you are not that dope, if that's all you got. Be a master at battling, but what else have you mastered? Can you rock a crowd? Can you rock a party? Can you rock a room full of five-year-olds in a kindergarten classroom? Can you rock a senior citizen home? Can you rock an audience of people who primarily speak Spanish but very little English? Can you rock that crowd? So there are all these different levels to artistic mastery, and we make excuses for it based upon, quote, record sales or, quote, success. If that's the only kind of success that you need to fulfill you, great. But what I assert is that success is much more holistic than that, if we're talking about 360 degrees of winning. But the true battle is against yourself. That's the battle in life. The true battle is against yourself. And I'm not against battling. I love a good battle, but half the people who are in battles don't need to be battling because you ain't ready to battle yet. And I don't believe that in the battle was the only place that you should train for it. So that's just my philosophy, and some disagree. I remember being attacked on panels saying I was trying to feminize hip hop and blah, 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 blah. And now I'm old enough where I don't care. I'm very clear. I've seen my philosophies and my theories proven over and over again. I've been horrible at documentation, but I know what I know what I know. And I stand by it.
Listen, I feel like this. Whoever got some against Auntie Toni, you... I'm from the north side of St. Louis. Got one of my homies on here from the way back. Don't let the Harvard fool you. When truth speaks, you can't knuckle up to that. You gotta own it. Like, you, the 360 degrees of winning, the holisticness, like the preparing, like the battle, the cypher is not where you're like, or the battle isn't where you're like, I wonder what I'm good at. Let me... And so I just love how you walked that out. And again, for folks who have not, who want to get more of this, cop the book, or we're going to have a book release party, however we can support. I'm here for it. But if like cop, go online and look at the work that Toni has done on this, because I do think that people miss it. And I mean, I know that I've experienced this, the traveling, not internationally. I mean, sometimes in some parts of the US, that like what hip hop culture is not what is packaged and marketed and monetized. It's these other digestible bits that fit into an algorithm that then change our taste buds as the demand makers, right? And so we lose that. There's a culture, there's a beauty, there is the 360 degree-ness, the holisticness of it. Folks miss that. And I think, so they think, oh, well, I saw a rap battle on whatever show. I don't know if music television shows still play music TV anymore. I don't know, but that's it. Or it's the, like, you know, I've been overseas. We're like, let me just clarify. I'm not a B-girl. I'm not a breaker. I got a few steps. I've been asked to like judge competitions. And I'm going, for me, the part I think that's missing, I'm like, where's your musicality?
Yeah.
Where's the play? It's not just let me like do a gesture, hand on crotch, take your head off. I'm like, you missed something. I'm not a B-girl, but I can tell you missed the soul of it. And so it cannot be overstated. And I think particularly as an educator also, that idea of seeing and being seen, of establishing the energy so we can try.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So that we can also, I think cyphers are like amazing assessment instruments without like being like an assessment instrument. Mm-hmm. Like, you can tell, are you rocking? Like,
right.
5-year-olds will let you know right away. Right. Nope. Right. Second graders and fifth graders, I don't know what it is about those levels. They will let you know. Not so much, miss. Not so much. I don't know. I know, anybody else? And so like there, you get that immediate feedback. And if, to go back to something that you pointed out earlier in your story, which I think is important, if you are so beholden to this other script of like what professionalism must look like, what assessment must look like, you'll miss how to react in a holistic way. And you'll be like, something's wrong with these kids.
Right.
But they're giving you feedback in that cipher that we need you to play a different record.
Yeah.
We're not trying to leave. We just, can you do something else?
Yeah.
And so, but when we're not a given space to appreciate the gifts that we have as humans, especially as folks of the diaspora, we miss it. And so we do think the cipher is about attack. And we're still trying to talk about the cipher, but be in this hierarchical framing of it. So I'm over here writing so many notes. And in a minute, we're going to open up for people to pose questions. In the chat, nothing beats the honesty of children. Like nothing. Like nothing. Their pauses will let you know. So I wondered, because many, what year was it? I forget the year that the film came out, but Beyond Beats and Rhymes, Byron Hurt's film. You had a quote that really, something you said really stuck with me. And it's something that I come back to in a loving, holistic way, not a like, I hate hip hop, something's wrong with me. But you said, you know, you felt like at one point in time you were in an abusive relationship with hip hop.
Yeah.
And how that, for me, I took that as like, how can we cultivate an actual relationship with hip hop, but not like this commercial participation? With it, we're like, yeah, I'm bending over to the front and I'm touching my toes. But when you came to that revelation at that time, And clearly, like you just said, you don't apologize no more. You know what the truth is. How would you describe what your relationship is with hip hop now and how you've navigated? Like, sometimes we got to take a break, or I actually go with the real hip hop. Y'all dating this imposter. Like, how do you qualify your relationship with hip hop now?
Well, you know that my relationship with hip hop was so deep because my whole life, I made my whole life hip hop. Every single thing I did was tied into hip hop. In 1992, I started the Hip Hop Arts Movement, which was known as HAM, which was a hip hop theater ensemble, performance ensemble, which then later, you know, was one of the first hip hop theater performance ensembles. And then I was a pioneer with hip hop education as well. And then all these, but everything in my life was hip hop. And so when I had to heal my relationship with hip hop, I had to heal me. Even my love relationship, one of my deepest, well, a few of my love relationships, but the deepest one, one of the deepest ones in my life was with a fellow hip hop artist, Ed, and a professional artist. And so my healing with hip hop was internal work, you know, and I've been saying this to a lot of people in my life, from, you know, my former interns to artists I mentor to people I collaborate with. There's no way around the internal work. You can put it off. There is no way around you having to do your inner work. You won't get to the kind of love relationship you want to have. You might get married, but you won't get to the kind of relationship you want to have without the internal work. You won't get to manifest your life's work and enjoy it the way you want to without your internal work. You won't have the physical health that you desire without doing your internal work. The family relationships with your parents or with your children, with your siblings, like, the internal work is such a critical part of our life journey, and remembering that it is a journey, it's not a destination. So in your mind, you might think you are here or you're good, but you know if you have not done your internal work. And that is how I was able to heal my relationship with hip hop. Now, some of it I did by choice, because I've always been on a self growth and development path, but some of it came by force. You know, like I had a burnout, a severe burnout crash in 2016, where I literally was in the bed for 3 weeks thinking I was gonna die. And then I was hemorrhaging from fibroids. I had swollen feet, ankles, and calves from edema. I was severely anemic. I had severe acid reflux. I couldn't lay down sleeping for 5 weeks. It was just like, that's not it. Then the eczema on top. And so it was that point of, is this it? Did I really wear myself out until the end? And I spent a month in Senegal. I canceled all of my commitments, but I still honored the trip. I spent 9 days sleeping, 10 days before I saw another human other than to walk to the market to get papaya and watermelon and water. And there was a space where I made a promise to the Most High. You know, I could hear the call to prayer every day, 5 times a day. I could see the people praying all over in the streets every Friday. And I made promises to God, if you get me through this, if I can get through this, because I've had health challenges my whole life. And that was the point where I really surrendered. I was when I let go. I mean, I was literally at the beach letting go. I was on the rooftop sitting in the sun letting go. And it took me about 1.5 years to heal my body. And really 1 year of going slow. Like 11.5 months of just going slow. And that is how I was able to get back on track. I didn't know it would be coming back to hip hop. I didn't know what was next, because I had let it all go. And then I had surgery. And then as I was recovering from, I said surgery October 2017, I was recovering. And by January, into January, things started happening. And then by the spring, something else happened. And I was like, damn, I wish I had taken time off sooner. And then at the beginning of 2020, big doors were opening. There was stuff on the table. And then a series of things just started to happen and everything was off, but I pivoted. I chose to pivot and I decided I wasn't going out like that. And I'm like, since, you know, since we are all walking on the edge of death, why not live? And that's what I did. I just decided to live. And I dug deep into my creativity, had no idea I would be rebirthing myself as an artist. I've recorded more music in the pandemic than I have in the last 10 years. I just shot 3 music videos in the last 6 weeks. I'm invited to be a part of a theater festival next month where we'll be premiering a work in progress of my new hip hop theater piece, Let the Cypher Say Amen. And it's like everything is coming full circle, you know? The publishing company called and said, hey kid, you know, my lawyer, Mickey, is like, kiddo, you ready to do that book? Out of the blue. And then-
But not out of the blue.
Not out of the blue. And then I had been wanting to do children's TV, and then I got to find out, do you really want to? And then Kwame Alexander, the children's book author, old friend, he's like, hey, T, you ready? I was like, ready for what? There I was in DC, and I had a 45-second segment on his children's TV show, Wordplay, where I was freestyling the word of the day for middle schoolers. And so so it was just different things like that just started to open up. And then the New York Times, Mindful Magazine, and Discover Magazine featured me in 2020 in relationship to my hip hop meditation.
Mm-hmm. So I'll ask you about that.
And so it's been like this, what happened? What changed? I made an energetic shift to let go and to stand in my power, to let go of my fear. And one of the biggest fears, and I was telling some young women about this, and they were like, what's the thing that you let go of? I said, I start worrying about what people are thinking about me. I start worrying what people are saying about me. And I said, for some of you, that's 50% of your battle right now. You worried about what your auntie's gonna say if you fail. You're worried about what your dad's criticism is because you decided that you weren't gonna use that law degree. You're worried about that and not living your own life. Man, it's so real.
Is it Wednesday? Because this is church. Listen. Tony got a word on a Tuesday.
And some people are going to let go of you. The challenge is, will you let go of them? Let go of the people who let go of you and let them be. And if you're good people, they all come back. The key is, do you really want them around close? They all come back.
My church man.
Let them go. Let them go.
Let them go.
And focus.
Let them go.
The universe will replace them. When I tell you the universe replaced those people, I even like, who makes new friends? Grown women. I made new friends during a pandemic. Like friends.
That's a whole Academy Award for life. That's great.
Don't get me started. Don't get me started, because then I start telling my business about what else. But I'm trying to be quiet because he said, keep your mouth shut about me in the streets.
Oh, I might have to text you later. I wants to know.
I'm telling you, man, it's so.
But you said it though. And I think I so appreciate your honesty, right? I would never be able to know based on just the energy that you're emitting, even through this screen, that there was ever a moment where you weren't at this level of honesty with self, because it's like so natural. Like, of course, none of this is out of the blue. You were like, the body was telling you, you know what, sis, we need to go ahead and enact emergency mode. We're not gonna take you out, but it's an emergency.
Yeah.
And there are some blockages that you're creating. And so I just love hearing that, you know, especially I think now as we all have our own stories around how we've navigated social, physical distancing and how different people have been able to handle like that time alone. And it's different when you force, when it's forced upon you, different when you select it, different when you kind of get to craft it. But to, I'm even encouraged just to hear you say you've had 9 days with no human interaction. And it wasn't like you was on the floor with a bottle of liquor crying about like higher body the left, like, you know, cause wait, that's me saying too much. Ooh, my therapist says I'm too transparent. There it is again, but that's different. And so I feel like I'm hearing from you that the restoration and the clarity needed is time. And so I'm so excited. Like, if for those who missed the intro, we got to hear a little bit of New Music Tuesday featuring Toni Blackman with the Worry track. Like, I've been bumping that thing. Like, why worry? Why worry? Why worry? Why? Why? You just said if we're all on the edge of death, why not live?
Yeah.
So I'm thrilled. Like, somebody wants to know, like, where's the theater festival? We like how we can see you though. Like,
yeah, the theater festival is Poetic Theater Productions is hosting this festival. And I think it's April 21st and 23rd, but it's going to be virtual.
Yes.
Okay. And so my performance is a multimedia performance, and it'll be online, so we'll be able to announce it. And but it will be a poetic, the festival's called Poetic License. Okay. Is the name of the festival. I think it's the 10th year of the Poetic License Festival. And the festival focuses on presenting theatrical works that are poetic of nature and in nature. And there's different events related to the festival, but there's also a new works event where there'll be a few pieces presented.
Okay. Well, again, listen, I want to respect that this is your third Zoom-a-thon, but I do want to, we want to make sure if there's folks who have any questions, you can drop in the chat. If you want to use the Q&A function, if you're on Facebook, look, I'm like a DJ over here with my two, with my two screens. I'm kind of proud of myself today. But if you have a question for this amazing human that you like to pose, please go ahead and speak now. If you want to unmute, we can afford those privileges. And then Toni, also, if you can drop, if there's any handles where folks can just keep a tab or a website where folks can find a way to just know what you're doing or what's coming next for you, if you can share that with us.
Where? Put it in the chat?
Chat, yeah. That's the new thing. Drop it in the chat. Move over, business card, drop it in the chat. Wow. So you've recorded more music than previously. So what's your favorite track that you done?
It's a track called Just Breathe that I collaborate with a vocalist, Javon Reynolds. He's from Detroit. My guitarist, Jerome Jordan, helped me produce it. But it was composed by Noel Grass, who is a pianist in Nairobi, who was recently nominated for a Jazz Award, Best New Jazz Musician. And it was Noel and Luke Okech, two Kenyan musicians in Nairobi, who I jammed with in 2019 when I was there. And I finally got to do the track the way I heard it in my head. The choreographer and dancer Giselle Mason used it in.
I know Giselle. Look, we already cousins.
Well, she used it in her New Year's Eve piece. And I'm really, really excited about that new work. And then I have a new one called I Love and Approve of Myself that I'm taking unconventional structures and approaches where every song does not have a hook. So it's basically the verse and then the affirmations, but being with the energy of a song. So we shot the music video for it with Stealth Star, a video producer here in New York City. And
listen, the titles alone, I'm like, these seem like affirmations I should just be writing and
it's the work, hosting
around my apartment.
It's the work that I really, it's my life's work. And this is the next phase is healing, well-being, promoting self-care in very practical ways. Oh, Juliana asked some ways you take care of yourself now and self-care techniques. Well, you know, how do I take care of myself now is is I have rituals and routines, and I'm very big on accountability partners. So if I am struggling with wondering if I'm going to be able to stick to this, I have no shame in saying, Aisha, I need you. Okay, can you this date to this date? What do you want to do? You down? You down? Okay, good. So like I have a meal prep accountability team. You know, it's two of my besties from college and undergrad. You know, the one is a little hesitant. And one is dealing with blood pressure issues. And the other one's like, oh, but I want you, I need to do it. So, but I'm bringing them both in so that then them being present makes me more present. And then when I needed to do the physical fitness, I went ahead and just like, look, it's going to cost me. This woman, another woman I knew had a special. I said, look, I'm so scared to do this, but I am not exercising on my own. So I've been exercising with her 30 minutes twice a week. You know, it's only 30 minutes a day, twice a week. But even that scared me because I hadn't made that commitment in so long. And the last time I tried to dance was in Giselle's residency, and I injured myself because I did too much because I don't have the strength. You know, I didn't have the muscles to support what I was trying to do. And so I was like, does this mean I can't dance anymore? He's like, no, just need to not be out of shape and rebuild those muscles. So I'm about that business. Accountability partners are everything. Nighttime rituals, morning rituals, revisit them, write them on the wall, put them in the beginning of COVID. I had it listed in my bedroom and I had it listed in my kitchen. I wrote it out with a Sharpie on small poster boards so that I would be constantly reminded when you wake up, boil a pot of warm water, pour lime juice, drink the whole pot of warm water. Drink your celery juice, get your aloe vera, eat a piece of aloe plant, put the aloe on your face, boil a pot of hot water. Now let's steam our face. Like I had my rituals, and that is what kept me sane during that time where people I knew were dying, when my neighbor died on the fourth floor, when my mentor died in the Bronx, when this person was dying, when I was reading about what was happening and listening to the sirens here in New York City, and it felt like a war zone. Like those are the things that kept me. And I really got clear about my showers. I took showers at night by candlelight. I warmed the room with a portable heater. I warm the water. I have my lavender Bronner soap. I have my music. I have my candlelight. And so every night is special. No matter what kind of day I had, hey, I'm not at a retreat center or at a five-star hotel, but every night for at least 10, 15, 20 minutes is special.
Listen, Stephanie, there's another question too, but Stephanie just was reading my mind. I'd pay for your morning and nighttime ritual list if it could help me get to a fraction of how amazing you are. I know. And I'm like, look at it. Like, look, Huli also was into it. I'm like, look, so I'm going to get this aloe plant. You the second person I know who's like celery juice. I was like, me and celery have a very clear understanding on where we stand with each other. We don't. But you and the other dope sis that I know has gotten into this celery. I was like, but listen, clearly it's part of some type of formula. Thank you for sharing that. It sounds so beautiful. I'm like, wait a minute. Let's see. What candles can I pull into the bathroom and not accidentally cause a fire tonight? Because I'm going to try. I'm going to let you know. Yeah, I'm going to try.
Girls in the dark.
So Kelsey asks, can you speak to overcoming your fear of looking internally to do that work?
Well, my fear of looking internally is I was afraid of how much work would be required. And that's the thing, just surrendering to the fact that one, there's effort involved. Two, there's going to be labor. And sometimes that comes with heavy lifting. And then three, it takes time. But here's the thing, the time is going to pass either way. So you can take a year or you can take 10 years to then take the year. But you're going to have to take that year. And so I think that's the thing, getting really practical about it, enrolling, finding a good therapist if that's what you need. Sometimes it's not a therapist you need. Sometimes you need a healer. Sometimes you need an energetic healer who's good at counseling and knowing what you need in the moment paying attention to what do I need now and not listening to what other people need, because what you need might be different. You might need a colonic therapist who likes to talk while you're releasing and you get three sessions. You might need a massage therapist who knows Reiki and acupressure, who likes to have small talk at the beginning, you know, those sorts of things. And you might need to practice Qigong to just slow down because you can't meditate. Everybody, some people, my girlfriend's like, child, I can't meditate. I can't say, then just be still. Sit down for 30 minutes. If you can't do nothing, read a book. Right? It's like there are levels to.
There's levels. Listen, I told people, like, my meditation, because I'm not, it's for me to get still, I have to move. And so my meditative practice involves movement and a lot of different type of circles.
Yes.
And I had to also release whatever I thought that script was. I'm doing it wrong, right? Like you said, my purpose was my purpose before. I knew I've been a mover my whole life. I got to the world early. So like me being still and waiting is just not in, right. It's not in here. So,
yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, oh, my homie from the Lou, Clayton says, can we hear some bars?
Okay, we just shot a video yesterday. I'm gonna do the verse. To keep it in the meditation vein. I'll do that, and maybe it'll lead into a freestyle. Maybe not.
I mean, if you want me to go first to like take the pressure off.
Hey, go ahead.
No, I don't have any.
Okay. This is woke up early in the morning. Woke up this morning. Okay. Meditation ain't just for the monks or Zen. It's for the everyday us who grind in. We gotta know it's for the people. Whether you pray to Allah or kneeling at a steeple. It's for the schools and for the streets, for the hood and athletes, young, old, and each and everybody in between. Nah, me. For your whole crew, you don't need a guru. You just need to be still, you and me. Cause set our minds free if we sit quietly for a few. Life can be like a zoo. Don't let it beat you black and blue, boo. A breakdown makes way for a breakthrough. So breathe through it to get through it. Drama is addictive, but trust me, peace is lit. Yeah. Peace is lit. Yeah. Woke up this morning. I forgot the hook. I did it 100 times yesterday. But it was the whole idea is you can't believe it just because the mind conceived it. And so it's this idea of not believing everything you think, and that you are in control of your thoughts and you are not your thoughts, and you get to define what your thoughts are to be for you. And so I've just been diving deep into like, what is it I'm struggling with, and writing a verse about that thing that I'm struggling with.
Fire emojis, somebody in the Q&A, that's tough. That was, so I mean, this is why I'm like so excited, feel like a little selfish, like y'all welcome that I have an appropriate crush on Toni to reach out and be like, hey, can you do this? Because I think something you said earlier, it is also clear, and I am not an MC, but I feel like because I grew up listening to different folks and like, Rakim is like one of my favorite first, right? Yeah. It's like, you can tell when someone is not playing around with the energy that is attached to lyricism.
Yeah.
And I'm here for a quick little two-step. I twerk, it's fine.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because that's a chakra. You got to loosen it. You know what I'm saying?
You got to loosen it.
Shake that chakra. Though at the same time, there's something that I can tell, like you said, like you just went, you did. Because you have done that energy shifting work. You spent that time going, okay, what we doing? What we got? I'm ready. This is how I'm preparing. So that somebody who's never met you, whose face you couldn't pick out of a crowd, drops a note into Q&A saying, can you drop some bars? And guess what? You're ready.
Yeah.
And it's beautiful.
Yeah.
I'm like, so just to be clear. Is the album, is the music public consumable yet?
Well, you know, one of the things that I am growing into is embracing my art as it is and releasing perfectionism, which is, I know, a disguise for fear, and stepping all the way in. And that is what 2021 is about, which is why I went ahead and while I had the opportunity to have these videographers around, and I'm making the music videos. And that's why the theater piece will also center my music. It's a musical piece. And it's funny, Denise Sincerity Garcia, who's an MC from one of the artists that I've mentored, who is much younger than me, but she, my 20-something mentor, I mentor her, she mentored me. And so she walked me through setting up that Rhyme Like a Girl song, Let's Chill, on DistroKid and putting it out there for consumption and for people to have access to it. Although we don't have a video, we don't have the artwork, it was an exercise in letting go. And so now I feel closer, I feel ready. I have a few college friends that are waiting on a business plan, which of course I've been procrastinating on that. So I know that I'm in a great space because I have people saying, hey, I want to invest in you. I want to support you. And what it's challenged me to do is to let go of the people who have said opposite, to let go of the no's, to let go of the rejection, and to let go of the need for acceptance from others, and really honing in my attention on those who have said yes, Toni, and who have affirmed me and who are uplifting me and trusting my process. And knowing that when you are creating something new, fresh, different, when you are an innovator, you don't always get support in the beginning.
Yeah.
I mean, I started doing this work 2013 with a creative partnership that ended very badly and a lot of pain, but I stayed the course. And then who knew that we were gonna have a global pandemic and that people were gonna be crying out for what it is I was offering the world. So I have spent the pandemic catching up with myself, you know, and just now catching up. I feel like I've just now caught up since the pandemic began to feel ready for the opportunities that are in front of me. It's crazy. Like doing a thing and then all of a sudden everybody's like, oh, you got more? You got more? Where is it? Where is it? So I'm in that space now.
Okay.
Yeah, pulling it all together.
Well, I'm so grateful that you have been able to like really appreciate yourself.
Yeah.
And that you are clearly an exemplar of showing up to do the internal work.
Yeah.
So that you can really then just straight top rocking your purpose. You just out here two-stepping in your purpose in divine timing and rhythm. As we wrap up, there's something that you said, and you know, maybe it's because, again, there's some like, maybe if we just tried hard enough, we could be a MC. But you mentioned something that you do with middle schoolers, and shout out to anybody who's a middle school educator. Y'all always get a special place in my heart. But the freestyling the word of the day. So I wondered if we could give a couple of words, maybe if folks have a word of appreciation for the time that we've had with Toni, if you can drop that in the chat, like think long, think wrong. That's space right there. You think long, think wrong, don't renege though. But like if folks could drop a word to show appreciation for this time that we've had, maybe there's a little freestyle word of appreciation moment. Listen, I ain't prepper, but you stay ready. You ready with the pew, pew, pew all the time, you know? So, I mean, I got a word, but so I'm gonna just type my word. Maybe that'll... Okay, so we got one word. First word, energy.
Energy. First word is energy.
Yep. You got two more came through. So I'll give you a moment. I'll just let you know. Energy came through, grace came through, and healing. Energy, grace, and healing.
Energy, grace. Thinking about energy, the vibration. I said energy is moving me. Energy exchange between you and I. Energy helps us focus on the truth and put down the lies and let them go. Energy is what helps us flow. Energy, it leads us to grace so we can be graciousless within our face with our own selves when we look in the mirror. We close our eyes so that we could better hear her. We open our eyes so that we won't fear what it is we see, because the energy, the energy takes us higher. The energy will help you set yourself on fire. The energy will have you spitting flames. The energy will have you praising God's name, the Most High. Said sometimes you will cry, but that's okay. Your feelings you cannot deny, because if you surrender to what it is you're feeling, that is the key to unlock the healing that you're feeling deep inside your heart. The healing right now, tonight is where we start the healing. I want you to never part from the truth. Let the truth be your guide. Let's go on a healing ride with HipHopEX tonight. And walk to the light. Energy, grace, healing now. Energy, grace, healing now. Energy, grace, healing now. Energy, energy.
Feels inappropriate that I say anything right now other than dang, yes, I need the air horn sound effect, like exclusive. That was beautiful. And that is mastery. That is knowing the craft, because again, you stayed with the words. And I was like, I used it once and I let me diss on your moms. It was like the whole essence, the beauty, like, oh, just get this love and just get your roses. Y'all made my day. You made Clayton's day. Clayton had a birthday this week. Juliana got nothing but fire. Yes. Wow. That was so incredible. Thank you so much, Toni. I just want to say I am so encouraged and I'm more than inspired, because I think sometimes inspiration becomes a cop-out to, like, I just feel something, but I feel inspired to beautiful agitation, to keep going, to show up for myself and that internal work. I'm like, who can be my accountability squad? I feel affirmed that terminology, intuitive facilitator. I'm like, yeah, my preparation is to know that my energy is right, to cipher with the moment. Mm-hmm. I'm also thinking about, like, I want to hold on to all those people that have been prophets along life, letting us know that you was already in your purpose before you knew to be about purpose on purpose. So I just am thanking you that little rapping 8-year-old little Toni in the backyard, high school or on a getting them step class right, that all of that was the training. You've been developing and conditioning your purpose muscles, and it's so beautiful to see that the work is well done. So I just want to say thank you so much for sharing a bit of your journey with us this evening. Yeah. Folks, if you are not, again, at Toni Blackman, mm-hmm. Toni with an I, Blackman with an A, not an O. I know there's some other Blackmans, but Toni Blackman, we are excited for the book. We declare that it's awesome. Ashe and amen. We're excited for the music to keep dropping. Ashe and amen. We're excited for the festivals. And we're excited that you're going to gift yourself some time to just breathe.
Yeah.
Without working with people. Give yourself a day.
I have an off day Thursday and then April 4th.
No, don't announce it online.
I was going to say my off week. I got an off week in April. Yes. Oh, and my YouTube series, How to Freestyle. I'm building it, developing it. And so it's on my YouTube channel. And the series is called How to Freestyle. I'm a behind. Women's Month was gangsta. I got a new video that I thought I posted, but I didn't. Yes, I saved it. But I'm going to share that tomorrow. And so I'm really excited about this series, because I feel like it's allowing me to be in my groove. I'm doing something I love. And so I'm writing the freestyle book as I do the series. So it's taking me a little bit of time in between. But I'm excited about it. And I've gotten such a great response from music educators. So I feel like I'm in service as well, so.
I love it. I'm like, clearly that's a YouTube series I'm gonna pull up to, because I wanna work on that. But thank you again. Thank you. Folks, We will be back tomorrow with one final day where we're talking with Melissa Park around Afrocentric social emotional learning framework as we close out our time to celebrate dope women for Women's History Month. So some more love to Toni. Thank you. Thank you everybody that joined us on all the interwebs, and y'all take care of yourself. Get that, that lavender and them candles in the bathroom, but don't have no accidents. Bye, everybody.
Bye. Thank you.
You're welcome.